Here's an experiment that demonstrates membrane asymmetry. And to explain this, I have to go a little bit into electrophoresis. The setup is shown here with a chamber above and a chamber below with a direct current or DC power supply. And we have an anodal chamber, which is the positively charged chamber, and the cathodal chamber up top. The proteins have been dissolved in solutions such that their net overall charge is negative. So when we turn the power on, when we apply a charge across a slab of gel, it looks like clear jello, the proteins will move towards the anode because they tend to be negatively charged. We're going to separate these proteins based on size. So when we turn the juice on, there is movement towards the anodal buffer chamber. Now what you saw moving was a blue dye that we threw in to the protein solution so that we could follow the electrophoresis until the blue dye reached the bottom of the gel, and then we turn it off. The blue dye has been chosen so that it moves faster than any proteins that we might have in the solution. We take the gel out of this apparatus. We stain the gel with a colorimetric dye that recognizes proteins generally and turns them colored, in this case a kind of a light blue. And so what you now are looking at are bands of proteins. Each band represents one or more proteins that has migrated at a rate that is proportional to the size, that is to say, the length of the polypeptide. Larger proteins move more slowly, so they'll be nearer the wells where they started. Smaller proteins move more rapidly. Now let's take a look at how this technique can be used to show membrane asymmetry. So here's a bit of phospholipid bilayer, and there are several proteins associated with this bit of membrane. We have three transmembrane proteins, proteins 2, 3, and 4. And on the inside surface, the cytoplasmic side of the cell, there are two additional proteins, numbers 1 and 5, which are peripheral proteins because they bind to the membrane either by binding directly to the heads of some phospholipids, as happens with 5, or they interact with integral or membrane-spanning proteins. That would be protein number 1, a peripheral protein, that recognizes and binds to some portion of protein 4. Now that's an asymmetric membrane, isn't it? It has different components facing inside and out. Let's take a look at how we can test that electrophoretically. We can treat the whole cell first with a proteolytic enzyme. It's an enzyme that will digest proteins and polypeptides down to their amino acids. Trypsin is an example of one of these, and it's one of the pancreatic digestive enzymes that digests the proteins in your diet. First thing we have to do is extract the proteins from untreated cells and look at them on electrophoretic gels. And here we see all our 5 proteins differ in size and therefore separate on electrophoresis. And so we have a cartoon of a gel with 5 different bands. The smallest protein is number 1, and so we would expect it to move fastest or towards the bottom of the gel ahead of all other proteins. It looks like protein 3 is the largest one, so it should be the slowest moving protein in the gel. So these are representative of the full size of the proteins you see here. Now let's treat this same cell with trypsin. So we'll add trypsin to intact cells, and then we'll extract the membrane protein. So you are now looking at intact cells that have been treated with trypsin, and the trypsin has digested parts of proteins 2 and 3, because that's all that's accessible to the trypsin in the outside environment of these cells. If we now extract these proteins and run them on a gel, we will see a gel that looks like the one that just appeared a second ago. Protein 3, remember it has a chunk of carbohydrates and proteins on the external surface. After trypsin digestion, that's been lost. After digestion, we would expect band 3 or protein 3 to be somewhat smaller and move faster, and indeed it does. And so you see protein 3 in the second gel has moved a little faster because it's lost some of itself. It's been partially digested. And likewise, protein 2 should also move faster in the gel, and it does. So in the second gel, we no longer see the original protein 3 or the original protein 2, but we do see 2 smaller proteins that have been derived from the originals by digesting intact cells. Now, it's also possible to chemically poke holes in cell membranes and allow the trypsin to actually get inside the cell so that the trypsin can digest not only what's outside the cell but also what's inside the cell. So we've added trypsin to a permeabilized cell of this sort, and what you expect to happen is shown in the cartoon. You should digest all of the protein components that are either on the inside cytoplasmic surface or the outside aqueous environmental surface, leaving behind only those portions of the protein that actually span the membrane. In this illustration, you would expect to be left with proteins 2, 3, and 4. Proteins 1 and 5 will be digested in their entirety. And what's left of proteins 2, 3, and 4 look, at least in the cartoon, like they should be about the same size. And indeed, if you ran a gel, once again, the peptides remaining in the membrane after permeabilizing the cells and digesting with trypsin are proteins 2, 3, and 4 all moving to the same position, that of the transmembrane portion of each protein in the cell membrane. This is an electrophoretic way of demonstrating that the membranes of cells are asymmetric.